Good morning. There we go. Good morning. Thank you for choosing to come and join us this morning. Just to clue you in, if you're visiting, this is not a typical service for us here at Crosswalk. This is what we're calling the Faraha Experience. You're going to get a chance to see what it is that Pete and Noah and Ann and Gordon and Trudy all experienced while they were in Faraha. So it's very exciting to see what's going on and what they have to share with us and what they've experienced over there. So I'm glad you made the time to come today. Couple things I want to clue you in about was during the service, we're going to have communion up here. So we're asking everyone to enter the stage over here on the east, and then you're going to leave on the west. Did you all get a little white paper that says if you have any questions for the crew? Fill those out, and when you come forward on the east, you're going to drop them off in the bucket up here. It says thanks for the questions. You'll go through and take your communion. You'll come out on the left, and then you can drop, or excuse me, yeah, on my right, your left. You can drop off your offering in the bucket over there and then go back to your seat. So it's going to be a totally different experience today. We've handed out cards to a lot of the people that were sitting down. If you don't have one, raise your hand and they'll bring one around to you. But I think we've kind of covered it. I put snacks on all the tables to make sure. So hopefully it's all covered so you've all got the opportunity to ask any questions you have. Also wanted to tell you that we do have lunch today for you. After the service, it's for everyone who's here who wants to come and join us and experience a Faraha meal. And to be honest with you, I think it's probably going to be a little gourmet compared to what they have in Faraha, even though, you know, they said to really tone it down because they don't do gourmet over there. But so I would like you to stay, and I would like you to try everything that they have. There are several different dishes that you can try. Just try a bite, because you're never going to understand what it is that those children eat and what they experience if you don't try it yourself. So please do that. We're going to have it set up back here in the courtyard. There's tables in the courtyard. There's tables in here. You can bring it back in here and eat it or enjoy it out in the courtyard. Excuse me. And then also there's a products available in the back. We would like you to really look at these and see if there's anything in there that you would like to purchase. The prices on it are what we set, not what they set. These are little businesses that are run by the guardians of the children back there. So this is what they do to raise funds so that they can support the children that they're taking care of. It may not be just their children, it may be their children and some other relatives' children or children that just have nobody that they take in. So we want to support them in any way we can. So that's why we have the products back there, so you get a chance to experience the items that they've started a business doing back there by making these products. So be sure you check those out and support the guardians and the children back there with that. And now I would like you all to join me in prayer. We're going to pray to open the service, and I would like you to bow your heads with me, please. Precious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for taking this crew over there and bringing them back safely. You protected them while they were there, and you kept them safe, and we thank you for that. Father, we are just so excited to hear what it is that they're going to share with us and the experience that they had over there in Faraha, and give us a little taste of what it's like over there. Thank you for that, and thank you for the vision that they're going to share with you. Father, we also ask that you would be with the leaders of When I Grow Up. They're the ones who first planted this vision with us and told us about this opportunity that we could go over there and go be Jesus. So Father, thank you, and please continue to wrap around them and continue to bring them the vision to help these wonderful children. We also pray for the leaders of Faraha. We pray that you would continue to give them strength and keep them well and give them vision on how to best serve these children in the slums over there in Faraha. Father, most of all, we're going to take an offering soon, and we're going to ask that you would bless this offering back. We're giving back to you what you've already given to us, but Lord, we pray that you would bless it and help us to use it wisely and to be good stewards of what you have given to us. We pray that you would also open our hearts and let us give it freely and willingly without any guilt or without any fear of what would happen if we don't. We want to just give this back to you, Lord, and your service and all that you do. Father, we thank you. We continue to pray that you would bless the people that are going to bring the message today and share with us what it is that they've experienced. Thank you, Lord. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Now I'd like introduce to you Grandma from the group that went to Faraha. And you know that's not Noah, right? Serving is what the kids eat. Actually, it's what the Faraha staff serve to us every day. And it's actually a lot more gourmet than what they normally eat. They are really big on hospitality, and they were feeding us really special things, far better than what they normally eat. Okay, first, just a quick rundown on our itinerary. We left San Francisco early Saturday morning, stopped in New York and Zurich, arriving in Nairobi Sunday evening. Travel time was about 24 hours. We spent Monday and Tuesday in Huruma. Every day, the Faraha staff gave us breakfast and lunch, some of the delicacies you'll be tasting later. We visited the school, went to some of the guardians' homes, visited businesses that were supported by Faraha's microloan program, saw the kids' safe houses, and tried to absorb the culture we were seeing around us. On Wednesday, we drove about 2.5 hours to the high school and spent the day being royally entertained. On Thursday and Friday, we were back in Huruma. On Saturday, we got to go on safari with some of the Faraha staff at the wildlife park that is adjacent to Nairobi. On Sunday, we went to church with the Kenyans, went shopping, and headed for the airport. We parted with Pete and Noah in Brussels and came on home, arriving Monday evening. I'm about to take you on a tour of Huruma. It's the second largest slum of Nairobi, Kenya, with about 750,000 inhabitants in a space of about 10 acres. Visualize that density. A few stats. Unemployment is estimated at 50 to 60%. 49% of girls between ages 12 and 21 have been assaulted. 45% of boys of similar age. In the Faraha community, 60 to 80% of the kids are orphaned. 40% are HIV positive. By the way, they are getting excellent treatment for that. 100% live in extreme poverty, which is defined as living on $1.25 or less a day, less than one Starbucks coffee. The photos may be somewhat disturbing, but the story I will tell is anything but. The typical reaction to photos like these would be to pity the Kenyans living there. Before I left for Nairobi, I was really worried about whether I could handle the emotional impact of seeing people, especially children, living in extreme poverty. As most of you know, I cry really easily. And I was envisioning myself walking around with tears streaming down my cheeks, unable to stop. As it turned out, I didn't shed a tear the whole time I was in Huruma. If you look carefully at the photos I'm about to share, you may see why. The living conditions are horrendous. No one should have to live that way. But pity didn't feel right. I do feel great compassion for people who don't know if they will eat or not, for people who live in deplorable conditions. But in the photos, and I'll coach you on what to look for, you'll see why these wonderful people are not to be pitied. In some ways, I envy them their positive attitudes. So let's head out. We'll start near Faraha Community Center, where the school is. The school is just to the left. This is a better part of town. We'll get to the part where Dan grew up in a bit. Dan is one of the founders of Faraha, the young man Pete has been telling us about the last couple weeks. Throughout the slides, you may notice laundry drying everywhere. You'll see the reason as we go along. Need a mattress or some linoleum? These were the fanciest stalls.
many breaths. Want your hair done? All of the women have attractive hairstyles. Chicken for dinner with some tasty fruit and veggies. How about a tasty snack? No, you won't be getting that delicacy. Need something moved? Most transportation is by cart. That tire in the middle of the back is the brake. Just lift the tongue and it stops, or at least slows down. There are quite a few schools in the room. Each group of different uniforms is for a different school. The public schools are nominally free, but you pay fees for uniforms, books, materials, etc. So most can't afford the free schools. Farah has some fees too, but subsidies are available. Look at those faces. Yes, there's trash all around, but notice how clean everyone is. Remember the laundry? With few exceptions, I couldn't help noticing that everyone dressed sharp and was clean, obviously taking pride in themselves. I don't know how well you can see this woman, but even her shoes are clean, in spite of the conditions of the street. At first, I felt uncomfortable taking photos of their poverty. I felt like a voyeur, like I was invading a private place. But when I mentioned that to Faraha staff, they told me that when we're with Kenyans, the residents know who we are and why we're there. They appreciate our support in all ways. They want their story told. And the kids are all hands. Moving along. Need some new furniture? Fresh veggies? More cute faces? Kids who are not in uniform are not in school, as we were there on school days. And we saw lots of kids without school uniforms. Now we're heading toward the river, to the area where Dan grew up and where some of our kids live. Conditions get much worse. And this was in dry weather. Just imagine adding rain to this equation. Here we are at the river. People live in those tin shacks. Here's the river, well within its banks right now, but in the rain, the homes flood. Here's the bridge. This is on the far side of the river. Notice the pigs foraging? Pork chops, anyone? Moving along the river. The path was so narrow and treacherous, I was almost holding my breath, hoping not to land in that lovely river. I saw only two older women. Heading back up away from the river, we passed this woman. Whoops, where'd she go? We lost her. Let's go into the building. This building under construction led to an interesting conversation with one of our bodyguards. Notice the rebar sticking up? Any builders care to comment? Samson pointed out that it's way too thin to support the additional stories that will be added to this building. I mentioned our building codes, and he said they have them too. It's just a lot cheaper to buy off the inspector than to follow them. There's also a lot of corruption in the water and electricity providers. Most power is illegal and dangerous. You may recall that the Faraha school burned because of faulty wiring. Fortunately, the kids weren't there. In the residences, the landlords turn off the municipal water spigots that at best are only on for a couple hours in the morning. Then they sell bottled water to people who don't know if they will eat that day. And it's not bottled water like we're used to. All of their water is polluted. The deck is stacked against the poor, designed to keep them in poverty. The good news is that as the Faraha students finish their education, most of them plan to come back to Haruma and make a difference for their community, just as the founders of Faraha have done. A start has been made in breaking the vicious cycle. Here are a few more businesses. The movie theater, chicken feet sausages, no, we're not serving that either. Want to get beautiful? A little divine intervention might be helpful. need a knife sharpened? No electricity? No problem. This lovely woman making and selling chapatis is a parent of Faraha kids and possibly a guardian to others. She was able to buy her supplies through a microloan from Faraha Community Foundation. These loans are quite small and are usually repaid within 3 months. The repayment record is 100%. These loans allow parents or guardians to earn a living for their families. This barbershop was funded by a microloan. While you're getting shorn, you can charge your phone and get your copies made. Get your shoes repaired, thanks to another microloan. This booth is for wiring money from your phone, another microloan business. And this is a store. You don't go inside, you do your business through that small window in the bottom left corner. Each of these businesses allows a parent or guardian to support his or her family. The Boys and Girls Safe Houses are in this building. They're for kids whose living situation is too dangerous for them to remain at home. As we were waiting to leave, we had some time to kill. Our drivers, our bodyguards, and some of the Faraha staff. The staff started calling me Shushu for grandmother. In this photo, they were doing the adorable high-pitched sing-song, bye, that started at the high school. More on that later. And now we're back at Faraha. I hope I've given you a view of both the horrendous living conditions and the attitude of hope and joy that pervade Huruma. While it's certainly heartbreaking, it's also uplifting to realize that there can be faith and joy in the midst of extreme poverty. As I've spoken to people since I came back, many have said that, sure, Kenyans can be happy because they don't know what they're missing. I don't believe that's the case. They have movies and some TV. They surely don't have an accurate picture of the Western world, but they are aware of our opulence. They are happy because they're grateful to God for everything they have, and they don't focus on what they don't have. When they pray, they don't ask for things. They pray in gratitude for what they have today. I could certainly take a lesson from them. You too? Education is the key to breaking the vicious cycle. That's what motivates the Faraha leaders. They're grooming the new leaders, and their example inspires the students to also want to get back to the community. Faraha is much more than just a school. It's a system that brings hope and a future to kids who wouldn't have a chance without it. Classrooms at Faraha are certainly very different from what I experienced teaching here in Mac. Some classes have 50 students. Desks are like half of a picnic table, about 4 feet long, with 4 students to a bench. For the assembly, they carried them outside to the courtyard. The rooms are about 15 by 20. There are no windows and no electricity. The light in these photos is from my camera's flash. This was the day they got jelly bellies for Pete's birthday. But enough about the handicaps. What impressed me most was the attitude and attentiveness of these kids. Even though crowded, they're paying attention. The lesson I watched was social studies. They were learning about the different cultural groups in Kenya. They stood to answer questions and remained standing until everyone had shared what they knew on the topic. When a student gave a good answer, the teacher prompted the class to applaud. When the question was fully answered, they all sat. The lessons are taught in English, even though that is a second language for them. When the lesson ended, it was lunchtime. They invited me to join them, so I got to experience firsthand what they eat every day. It was bland, but tasty. When everyone had eaten, some of the students went for seconds. Anne will be telling more about this in a little while. I couldn't help thinking that if I had eaten my bowl full, one or two more students could have had seconds. But then I also realized how important it is to the Kenyans to show hospitality to their guests. I know they were happier sharing with me than they would have been with more to eat. These 2 bookcases are the entire library for the whole school of 450 students. When asked if they want play equipment, they'll answer that they'd rather have books. When I came into the fifth grade classroom, it was break time, but almost everyone was working on lessons. Since the sun sets at about 6:30 year-round, and most homes have no electricity, this may be the only time they have to do lessons. On the left is the textbook. On the right, the student's response book. The story is about a cat and kittens, but the themes are homelessness, hunger, and safety. After every 45-minute lesson, there's a break. The little ones play in the courtyard. Once a day, the older classes go out for organized play in the lot that was the school before it burned down. You'll get a chance to try this game in a little bit. At the high school, the students prepared scientific demonstrations for us. They were most impressive. They study in large, well-lighted classrooms. They take their studies very seriously and have big plans for their futures. So far, there are only three classes. Next year, the first class will be graduating. One of the challenges is going to be how to help them continue their education. Many will be qualified for university, but won't have the money to go. When we arrived, they had a wonderful assembly plan for us. Here's a drill team. Here's a group doing an original dance. Mildred Owino's original poem about her life was so moving. We'd hope to show it to you, but that can't happen. If you want to hear her recite it, just Google, "When I Grow Up, Nonprofit." That's what she's referring to when she mentions We Goo. It's "When I Grow Up." Okay, let's take a tour of the high school. This is half of the lot. This is the back half, the back side of the school. Here's the garden, which will be much larger when they have a well. Right now, all water is trucked in. Here's the staff housing, inside a teacher's room, another staff member's room. Notice the iron in her hand, the kind you heat on a stove. This is the girls' dorm with the matron who lives with the girls. Here's that laundry again. This is their tuk-tuk, the only transportation they have unless visitors are there. This is where an ill student would ride to emergency care about 30 minutes away. After lunch was a soccer game. The guy in the red shirt is the school principal. You might recognize the guy in the middle in the white shirt. He's not in a white shirt right now. Here we are teaching the Kenyans the wave. They taught us a game where whoever was called out had to get up and dance. Here's Noah showing his moves. Here's Pete grooving. Then we got to see how it's done Kenyan style. Dar shared the whole series of Pete's birthday washing. This is just the finale. A Faraha staff member also had a birthday, and he got his washing. And of course, high schoolers like their pics taken too. As we were ready to leave, one of the ladies said, "Hi!" And the guys picked up on it. From then on, every chance they got, it was, "Bye!" Even at the airport. Drew a few stares. Smile. You've been to Kenya. Noah, you ready to teach us how to play balance the ball? Visualize playing this in a lot with litter and potholes in the playing field. But have a great time anyway.
Up and face up. terrifying.
All right. So for this, we need volunteers. So raise your hand, anybody? Anybody?
It's fun. We got a volunteer.
That'll get one right there.
You saw kind of how it plays. So everyone repeat after me. Balance the ball, balance the ball.
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 I take that ball.
I take that ball.
I put it here.
I put it here.
I papete, which means, sorry to interrupt, I papete means I dribble in Swahili, right? So that's like, that's what I would do with the drum. So I papete.
I papete.
And then it would be, I give it to you.
I give it to you.
And then the next person goes. Make sense? All right, so we're gonna give it a try. Use your big, loud, outside voices.
Balance the ball.
years, I've seen pictures of all the poverty throughout Kenya since my dad went for the first time. So due to this, my expectations were that I would be overwhelmed by the sadness and depression there in the impoverished areas. However, what I found was a lot different. The thing that ended up happening was I was overwhelmed, but I was overwhelmed with the happiness radiating off of the kids. They're extremely happy, and it was a very fun time. I remember I was very surprised at this, especially when I first saw how happy the kids were. Because most of the kids only get fed one meal a day, and they lived in cramped, tiny houses, much like this one behind us. And they have parents or one parent who make a dollar or less a day. So there was a point in our trip where we were able to feed the kids. And so I was put in charge of the third grade classroom. And I've never entertained kids before, so this was a new, entirely new thing for me. So I got to the classroom and I helped scoop up the rice and beans and gave everybody a bowl. But then, after that was done, I had to find a way to entertain them. So, being the person that I am, I started taking pictures of them. And because they're not as used to pictures as we are, they were very happy to see the pictures after I took them. So, especially this picture, for some reason, they laughed so hard, the entire class laughed so hard at this one picture. But it was a great, great time, and it was a lot of fun taking the pictures of the kids. It also shows how happy they were to take the pictures, and in general, to get the food as well. I could tell they were really thankful for it. And then another element that surprised me while I was there was how spiritual the kids were and the leaders were within the school. In fact, one of the most powerful moments for me on the trip was involved singing in a circle. So on the very last day that we were there, we always had this room in the entire thing in the Faraha area that we would eat at every day. That's where we ate our breakfast and our lunch. But the last day that we were there, we all gathered around in a circle, and we sang worship songs, and we prayed. And it was a great, great moment to be in this. It felt very much like a community and like a family. It was a very powerful moment, and you can see how spiritual they were. And then after we sang, we prayed. And the entire week I had heard the prayers by some of the leaders of the school. And they're really interesting to listen to what they pray for and what they like to pray for. So some of the main things that I think it was Josephine, the one that my dad's been talking about for the past couple weeks. She prayed for, along with a lot of the other people, she prayed for long and blessed lives. She prayed for the kids. She prayed for that the food would be blessed. But for one thing, she prayed for us, which was very surprising to me, because we live in a first world country we have a whole bunch of stuff, and she, and along with all the other leaders and kids, they live in the third world country, which was very cool for me to see that they love making us feel at home. So I think that the two elements of the happiness and spirituality are connected, and they feed off of each other. I think that's a reason that they're both happy and spiritual at the same time. So while walking around the school and seeing the happiness and spirituality, I noticed that the kids were very dedicated to their work. Each one worked the hardest, and they tried to be the best they could be, which is very rare in schools in America. After being in school for the past however many years and still in it, it's definitely a rare thing to see. So the dedication, along with the happiness and the spirituality, was found in the high school as well. We went to the high school the Wednesday that we were there. I think it was like the third day. It's a very nice place, and it was a very, very fun time. And what I found at the high school was drastically different than in standard American high schools. In American high schools, there is constant judging of other people, judging for how you look, judging for what you do, what your actions are, what you say, things like that. And there's a lot of stereotypes as well. but there is nothing like that in this high school that we went to. As you saw in the picture before, thank you for adding this picture of me dancing, as you saw, looking great. Yeah. So there was a point when the kids would start clapping, and whoever's name was being said. So there was a point where they did that, and the person would have to go up and dance in front of the entire crowd. So it was.
Go Nova.
Yeah, do it now. Okay. But as I said, people are clapping and everybody's going up, and actually they went up too, which we didn't get to see their photos. It was too sad. I don't know what happened to that. But anyways, you think that going up there, you feel super nervous, and you think about what other people are thinking of you. And after dancing, after coming back down and seeing, I didn't see any like hurtful judgment or judgment at all in their laughter. They laughed. It was sort of a supportive laugh. I don't know how to describe it, but it was not like you would find in an American high school. So if a classroom had started to do that at an American high school, I would be much less likely to do it, just because they would start judging and think like, oh, he can't dance at all, which is true. But still, same line of thing. But anyways, it was really refreshing to see how they don't have the judgment and the stereotypical aspects of in the high school or in the schools in general. They're all very, very pure about it. They're very happy about it, spiritual, and they have great dedication. And to see both schools and all the kids to have all this stuff on a high level was this amazing to see, a great experience. So I really hope that I can go back in a few years. It was just a great time, so thank you.
Hi everyone, I'm Gordon. So a little change of pace, I put together kind of a video montage. It's about 7.5 minutes. And I just want to do a quick intro to it, so, and then we'll watch it. Basically, my time there was defined by three overwhelming, nearly constant emotions. The first was joy. Everywhere you went, whatever we were doing, there was an overwhelming sense of joy. That everyone on the team, that we were there with a total group of total 15 people, and everyone that we met as part of the organization was just a wonderfully happy, joyful. And the second two things were an overwhelming feeling of gratitude. Not just grateful for what I have here, but really grateful that I was there at all. And that leads to the third and final thing, which was an overwhelming feeling of being proud. And I was proud of you. And I was actually grateful to you. Because you are the reason that I got to go. You are the reason that these children, over the last 10 years, we're all wearing 10 anniversary year t-shirts for Faraha, that this started 10 years ago with preschoolers being tutored for free in an apartment in the middle of the slum. And it initially wasn't for free, they were getting paid to do it. The four guys, Chris, David, Dan, and Carrie, they were getting paid because they needed money to eat. The idea came up that they were being overwhelmingly lobbied by a bunch of kids in the slum to tutor them for free. They started with that, and they've grown this initial generation of kids through the program. They create and build this boarding school that you've seen. And on the second day that we were in Faraha, I got to serve the lunch. You'll see some photos of that coming up. And in that moment, that is probably one of the most special moments of my life. Because in that moment, I was with you. You were with me. I was serving the food that this congregation has been paying for and feeding these children. And in that moment, I was part of two places at once. It was a really powerfully spiritual, really moving moment for me. And I cannot thank you enough. So there were two songs that stayed with me that were kind of in my head, and you're going to kind of listen to what was going on in my head, which is a scary place sometimes, but this is the one. So two songs that were really, really powerful to me that I'd been listening to before I went there. Two songs by U2, of course, because, you know, I've got this bromance with Pete, and we both love Bono. And the first one is Ordinary Love, which was nominated for an Oscar. And it's actually originally written about Nelson Mandela in South Africa, so you can see that there's some racial tension relevance there. And then the second one is called Invisible, which came out during the Super Bowl. And that is about this, exactly, actually. It's specifically written for and to raise funds for people in extreme poverty. So it was done by the Red Organization, if you know what that is. So go ahead and hit it.
The sea wants to kiss the golden shore. The sunlight
So there's a line in the early line of that song that's like, I would finally know my real name. I won't be the same when you see me again. Ann and I spent a lot of time in the seventh grade class. They gave me a Swahili name. My Swahili name is Juma. Juma means Friday. I don't know why. They gave Ann a Swahili name of Saida. Saida means very polite girl. But the thought that I want to leave you with is, as wonderful and as awesome as that experience was, there is so much more to do. And what we've done, what we've been able to help with up until this point, is get this grade of preschoolers all the way up to their junior year of high school. Next year, these juniors will be seniors. And then what happens? Because these are now children that can't afford to go to university. They don't have an income stream. Some of them may not all be academically ready to go to university. How do we get them into junior colleges? How do we get them into vocational training schools? And if we aren't able to deliver on that promise, this idea of education then bettering their lives fails. There is so much more to do. And I am so grateful for your undying love and your bottomless compassion. And as much as I want to go back there, and I made so many friends on this trip, they are actually not best served by me going back. They're best served by someone else going. Someone else from this congregation going, so that you can spread the word. Someone else that isn't a part of this congregation going, that we can foster kind of new relationships, new experiences, and the fire that is caught here at Crosswalk that supports what they do, then spreads. There is so much more to do. Thank you.
Feel like you've visited Kenya by now without a 20-hour flight. Although I have to say, I mean, just looking at this picture, you can see that there were some really spectacular moments on that flight. And next slide. There were so many times throughout this trip where I looked around and I was like, wow, this is really beautiful. Even in the midst of all the trash or human waste, there were so many moments that were just really, really beautiful. And like Gordon said, a lot of what I'm going to say is going to echo what everyone has said before. But I want to share with you a few snapshots of our time there and a few things that really stood out to me. So first of all, next slide. This is what you're used to seeing, because this is the part that we're involved with. This is what we do, and I want to tell you how really, really, really important this is. So every day, all of the students get fed a meal, and thanks, I'm going to need that. Everyone gets fed, and for a lot of these kids, this is the only meal that they get all day. And we know this because we met a lot of guardians, and when we talk about the guardians, first time someone mentioned it, I was like, who are the guardians? I know, I was like, guardians of the galaxy? But it's the parents or parental figures. So a lot of these kids don't have a parent, but they have an older sister or a cousin or an aunt or someone who's not even related to them who's caring for them, and that person is their guardian. Next slide. So we got to be part of feeding these children at Faraha, and like Gordon said, it was really amazing because it did really feel like you were all there with us. Next. And every day, so the younger kids line up in the courtyard there and you serve them. The older classrooms, you bring in one of those buckets of food and kind of scoop out the food, and everyone lines up with their bowl. So we got the chance to be feeding the seventh grade classroom. And as I was scraping the bottom of the rice bowl, you know, everyone came and they got their first serving, and I was giving the seconds out, and as I was just scraping the bottom of this plastic bucket of rice, I just thought, man, I could probably give $5 more a month. Because it was so real at that moment. What we do is putting food into people's bellies and guaranteeing a meal that might not happen otherwise. And so if you wonder, is this really doing anything? Is this worth it? I have to say yes. Yes, it is. Next slide. But it's also part of a much bigger picture. So you can see behind Gordon there, you see that that's the slum. I mean, the courtyard, the school. We're in the middle of Haruma. And next slide. And for me, this was kind of a familiar sight. So I lived and taught in Vietnam for a little over 3 years. And the laundry drying out, the buildings that might even be new but are already crumbling, just the marks of poverty were things that I was sort of familiar with. And there were so many times when I thought, man, a lot of the world lives like this. And so it's not something that is only in Haruma, but it's still really moving to see. Next. I don't want to say that like there's something noble about poverty, because there isn't. Poverty really sucks, and you see it everywhere. There are these like little serpentine paths through these makeshift homes that are really not homes. And you're going through there, and I have to say that Tuesday in Haruma, I got really overwhelmed with the noise and the crowdedness and the people everywhere and the dirt and everything, and I went back to our hotel and I was like, I need 30 minutes of total silence. Because it's overwhelming. And yes, there is a lot of joy, but it was still overwhelming because we're visiting these homes and you see that it goes on and on and on and on. Next slide. So how do you deal with that when there are so many kids in need? Like, what do you do? For me, it just started to feel a little overwhelming. And then I realized that something really, really brilliant is happening at Faraha Community Foundation. Next slide. So this is Sharon. You can see I'm shaking her hand there. I don't think she knew what I was doing. She was like, hey, white lady, what? You're shaking me. but we had met Sharon's guardian, her mother, earlier that day, and we would call her Mama Sharon, because all the parents are kind of called by their child's name. So Mama Sharon had led us into her home, which was tiny, and I had sat on the bed right next to her, and she had told us about how her husband was no longer around, and how she had had a depression that really broke her. And she was, for a while, unable to do anything. It sounded a lot like postpartum depression. And for me, that really hit me, because as someone who has dealt with depression in life, I thought, what would it be like to not have any kind of treatment or any access to treatment or be able to afford it at all? Like, no insurance, nothing. And I thought about how different my life would be in that circumstance. Next slide. But as you can see, Sharon is really well cared for, and she's a joyful little girl, because her mother is guaranteed this one meal a day, which takes stress off of her. And she's also the recipient of a microloan. So her mother sells kale and other vegetables at a stall on the street, and she gets microloan money for that. It's not a lot, it's really not, but it's enough for her to make sure that she has the fresh vegetables, and because you gotta have some money to make some money, right? So if you have nothing, how do you start? So it gave her the money to make some money, and now she's able to repay that loan, and now she's getting a larger loan. So, next slide. So the microloan program, here's another microloan program. This man is now, he redoes people's shoes, repairs shoes, and makes new ones. You can go and have your foot measured and have the shoe made for you. And he's a recipient of one of these microloans. Next slide. And if something did happen to Sharon's mother, and she wasn't able to care for Sharon, she would go to the safe house. And this is the view from the safe house. You can see it's kind of a better end of town of Haruma. Which, I don't know, maybe you can't see that, but it is. But this is a place that's meant to be a temporary safe house. So most of the kids there are only there for a short time until their guardian can get on their feet and have them back in their life, right? Next slide. And when Sharon grows up, she can go to this high school. If she works hard and she gets good grades, she can go to this high school, which is already there, right? And so that's the way to do this. The people at Faraha, the leaders at Faraha Community Foundation, have realized that you care for each child as an individual and for the whole child. And as a result, a whole community is affected. These microloans that are given to one guardian, now that guardian may be able to employ someone or employ someone else. And this resonates throughout the community. This is like a drop of water with rings, right? Next slide. So one thing that really struck me at the high school, I was talking to a few girls, and you can see visible scars on their faces of the lives that are difficult. They haven't led easy lives. They've led extraordinary lives. That every life, I feel like every time I was talking to someone about their life, I felt like, man, we could probably write a book about this. And I felt that way about every girl I met. So it's really important that these girls and boys are cared for as a whole person in every aspect of their life. Next one. And so throughout our visit there, we had a lot of blessings poured out on us. And that was one of the moments when there were so many moments there where I was like, I wish everyone could be here and see this and experience it. So one of the things was, we were at the high school and walking through the field, and it was literally a breath of fresh air. I mean, I go from Tuesday, crowded slum, noisy time, to the high school. I was like, yes, yes, thank you. So we're walking along, and one of the teachers was just telling me how grateful they are. She said, We're so grateful for everything you've given us. We're so grateful that that you're part of this and that we can do all of these things because you are supporting us. And I kept thinking, I'm not doing that much. I'm just giving $30 a month to the 360 fund. So I just felt not worthy of it. But then I realized I can accept this as a thank you for all of us, because it is, it really is. And she started just pouring out blessings. She said, I pray that God blesses you in your marriage, in your work, in your life, with your future children, on and on and on. And these are blessings that Faraha Community Foundation is sending to you, because they are so grateful for everything you've done and continue to do. Next slide. And so every day before lunch, we would wash our hands. And so when they'd say, okay, go wash your hands, I was expecting like some spigot somewhere. But no, someone comes in with a basin and a pitcher of water, and you have the dial soap, you get a little soap, and someone pours water over your hands. Someone else is standing there with a towel, and you dry your hands on the... For me, having gone through the slum and knowing that every single guardian we spoke to knew exactly how much water they use every day, and they know this because they don't have the running water. So they have to, next slide, they have to walk to the corner, haul their buckets, fill up their buckets, pay for that water, and then haul it home. So everyone knows how much water they're using every day. Next slide. So for us to just have someone pouring water over my hands, something as simple as that, really felt like someone was pouring out a blessing on me. Next slide. And that seventh grade class that we met, who called me Saida and called Gordon Friday,
they, on Thursday, they came up to me and gave me this necklace. And they had made it for me. And they were like, we've made you a necklace so you could wear it at your wedding. And I just thought that was the sweetest thing. These kids who don't know if they're gonna have the next meal had made a necklace for me. And I just know that they would have made one for everyone here if you had been there. Next slide. So we just got constantly blessed by being there. And I want to thank you for allowing us to travel there as your representatives. And also thank you for all that you do. And it may seem like it's small. You might say, well, we just feed, or I only give this much. But I have to tell you, it's doing a lot. It's doing a lot. It's changing a whole community. And that is really exceptional to see. Because as someone who has worked overseas some, I see how really, really difficult it is to change anything. I mean, when I lived overseas, first of all, I was a foreigner, so I got almost nothing done because I was just trying to figure out what was happening around me. But here are people who are from this community. They know what's needed. They're taking what we can give, and they're really making it super effectively used. So it was really good to see all of that. Next one. So there was a verse that kept, I'm sorry, I'm having an allergic, having an allergy, I'm allergic to emotion. So actually at that high school when, after the teacher had been pouring out these blessings and I started to cry and Gordon came over and was like, you okay? And I was like, yeah, I'm just, it's the allergies. No problem. So there was a verse that kept kind of sticking out to me while we were there, and I wanted to share it with you. It's from Isaiah 58, and God is telling the people of Israel about their fasting, and they've been doing it wrong, and so he's kind of correcting them in it. And they've been fasting, but they've still been mean to their servants and unkind to one another. So this is from Isaiah 58. Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen? To loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke. Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe him and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood. Then your light will break forth like the dawn and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, here I am. If you do away with the yoke of oppression and the pointing finger of malicious talk, and if you spend yourselves on behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness. Your night will become like the noonday. The Lord will guide you always and will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land. And you will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. Your people will rebuild the ancient ruins. You will be called the repairer of broken walls, the restorer of streets with many dwellings. And truly, that's what we saw. We saw people who were restoring the streets, and people who we're repairing broken places, and you're a part of that. And I hope that that brings you joy and encouragement.
So this is God speaking now. We get an opportunity to take communion, and how it's going to work. You're all welcome to take it. Going to go up to the right side of the stage that you see, get your hands washed. I'm going to meet you inside that dwelling. The inside of that dwelling you see is just about an exact size of most of the homes that these kids live in. When you get in there, you'll get a feel for what that might be like. The only difference is that all of your earthly belongings would have to fit in that, not just yours, but 8 to 10 other people as well. You'd have to fit a couch in there, all your cooking utensils, maybe a coffee table, and somehow you're supposed to sleep in that environment. So we want you to have communion in there. And in a moment we're going to pray, and I hope that communion is this really true communion, not just you and God, but I hope that you recognize that when we're in there together, I'll take 10 or so of you at a time, that you eat the same bread, drink the same cup as they do, that we all draw from the same Christ who gets them through every day. And that Christ calls us, heals us where we are here in Napa, California, but also calls us to do great things with what we have. So that's our opportunity coming forward. The song that you're going to have play and repeat as we take communion together was from a worship service we attended just 2 weeks ago today. And it was, or 3 weeks. And it was fantastic, and I don't care if you get tired of the song, you need to hear it. So I look forward to that. We do have a Q&A bucket up there, and if you have questions you'd be curious to ask for the team, drop those in the bucket. I don't think we're going to do those today just in light of time. We'll do like an online thing you can come view or figure out a way to do that. But we would love to know what you're wondering about. So as soon as communion is done, mingle, then we will start lunch as soon as we can. Does that make sense? All right, let's pray together. So God, what an extraordinary thing you're doing in our midst. What a privilege we have to go and be your servants, literally half a world away. What a gift it is for us to be able to look into these faces and love them. And to be a part of their story. And they're a part of ours. We don't go there, we don't see their images, we don't hear their songs and see their dance without being changed. We are one. They're not invisible. We see them, and they see us. They are our brothers and sisters, and we are their brothers and sisters. I pray, God, as we take communion together, that we will be warmed by the reality that you are a God who strangely meets their needs in spite of their lack of privilege and lack of material resources, that somehow they have joy in spite of their surroundings. I pray that we would be warmed by that and recognize that you are a God who meets us in our deepest need, that you love us endlessly, and that you will see us through just as you see them through. But I also hope, God, that just as they have learned to steward their lives well, that you will cause us to wonder, what can we do with our lives, with all of the resource that we have, with our education, our time, our talent, our skill set, and our wallets? What can we do to help our brothers and sisters even more? May we have communion with you and them and each other today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's do communion.